Greetings to everyone. Namaste. This is Dr. Dakshayani R. Patil, Associate Professor, BMS College of Architecture, Bangalore. Welcome to VTU eShikshana program, a wonderful e-learning platform by Vishveshwaraya Technological University, Belagavi. We are doing the course Building Services 3, code 18ARC63 for BIARC 6th semester under VTU for this E1 semester 2021. And under the Building Services 3 discourse, I shall be discoursing modules 1 and 2. And the module 1, which is already completed in the previous e-sessions, includes mechanical ventilation and introduction to air conditioning, basics of refrigeration, certain fundamental terminologies, and the refrigeration cycles mainly. Module 2, which we are going to resume today, is about air conditioning systems. To get an overview of the syllabus at hand, the syllabus aims to develop the knowledge and skills required for understanding the mechanical services in buildings and their integration with architectural design. So this is in the series of services that you learn across the entire undergraduate program for architecture, beginning with water supply, sanitation, electrical services, acoustics, and now coming to the mechanical services that include mechanical ventilation, air conditioning, mechanical transportation, and firefighting. So module 2 has two sections. The first section is about air conditioning systems, various types, that is unitary and central. And we will learn the various types and their principles and functioning in the upcoming sessions. The last section in module 2 deals with specialized AC systems. This is a list of books and various handbooks that are mentioned for reference in the syllabus, which we can all go through. Also, the number 7 and 8 are important ones, that is National Building Code of India 2016, a one-stop information for most of the building services. And I would also recommend a few extra readings as we move ahead, one being the book by Edward Peter on air conditioning principles and systems. So let us begin the session, module 2. This will be the lecture 1 under module 2, and the title goes Air Conditioning Systems. So in this particular session today, we will be looking at the definition of air conditioning, a brief look at the history and evolution of how the air conditioning got introduced, and the progressive years ahead, scope and applications of air conditioning in buildings, components of a typical air conditioning system, the various classifications, and we will get a brief look at unitary and central AC system, which we will be dealing in detail as we move ahead with the lecture sessions. And I will also recap the previous e-class learnings at the end to sum up the session. Now, air conditioning is one of the most important mechanical services in a building that was invented, developed over the years for the benefit of human comfort. So, one of the most interesting sayings that I found was by British scholar Markham, who wrote, "The greatest contribution to civilization in this century may well be the air conditioning, and America leads the way." So most of the innovations have happened there, and it is still evolving with the best of cutting-edge technology. And now, in the current era, the added ingredient of energy-efficient design, creating sustainable habitats, is very crucial and taking the forefront. The developed countries have already moved ahead. Developing countries are catching up. So that is one of the things that we have to all get acquainted with as well. Now, before we plunge into understanding the technicalities, a look at the history of air conditioning. Now, humans have evolved over the ages, and there wasn't air conditioning ever. It is only last one century probably that it came into the it came into our homes, offices, etc. Now, to begin with the prehistoric times, what were the modes of keeping oneself warm or cold? During winters, the two extreme climates, open fires, they were the source of warming. Fire itself was a wonderful thing that man encountered. So that was the respite during prehistoric times. And during summers, a good shade was giving the respite, along with usage of cold water, chilled water, for the relief from heat. And so to say, if you look at it, there have been millions of years where man has lived happily without air conditioning in some way or the other. So it was quite a long stretched era until the time when air conditioning got invented. So we have gone millions of years without any significant progress or introduction in this arena. And then came much later the Romans, who introduced the radiant heating systems in their buildings, which we call as hypocaust. We have studied this in our history of architecture. Then Middle East, the arid, dry, hot climatic zones, they used wet mats. So this came to be known as desert coolers. Then eventually we gave rise to the evaporative cooling technology. Most simple principle of air blown over a wet surface picks up the moisture, gets reduced in terms of its temperature. Right, and in dry seasons, SI seasons, it also increases the humidity, giving to comfortable conditions. Then there were the Korean Ondol floors around 1000 BC. So it was basically on heating the floor on which we live. So the floors were giving that heat comfort during during colder seasons. So you can see that the usage of chimney and some kind of a heat source to heat up the surface or the floor on which we sit, live, and do activities. It made sense because the actual heating was happening in the occupied zone of a room. So occupied zones are the area or volume of the room where we sit and do our activities, that is maximum 2 meters from the floor. Cooling or heating above that, just under the ceiling, makes a little no sense because we have to be comfortable. The intent of conditioning the indoors to comfort conditions is for the users. So these were some of the progresses that happened much later though. And then you can also see the use of water. In the royal family of the Han dynasty, there was an air-conditioned room usable for both winter and summer. It is warm in winter and cool in summer. So beautifully the technology started to evolve. Man started to realize the importance of water and air as the fluid media to create the required heating or cooling. And they also started off well with using the floor as a medium for conditioning. So that was right at the occupied level and made sense. In Europe, Leonardo da Vinci, he was the first to introduce a fully developed evaporative cooler. That is a picture to the right. It was a ventilator and cooling unit invented in the 15th century, right? And mostly that was the era of the kings and queens, and a lot of inventions happened to pacify them. But the actual formal discipline of heating, ventilation and air conditioning only grew during the last century. A little over the last century. So that is the progress with which we have moved, and then there has been no looking back. The air conditioning industry has been flourishing, has been giving rise to many innovative developments, though there was a hiccup because it was one of the industry that was leading to the environmental hazard by ozone depletion, which we have briefly seen when we did the refrigeration session and the importance of refrigerant in the refrigeration cycle. Then so far, USA has been the largest consumer. They were the ones who invented, and also being the largest consumer, probably, you know, owing to the extreme climatic conditions, it is imperative that such a system be in place. These are the Persian wind catchers. Wind catchers are even popular to this day. Architects have been using this element in their designs, especially in the dry, arid regions, wonderfully well. To understand why it is important to conduct an environment or design an environment indoors for the comfort and safety of humans, because a typical person spends 90% of his time indoor. Probably now it's a little reduced owing to the traffic and long working distances, but on an average 90% of our time is spent indoor. So when you are indoors, it is essential that you are in a safe, clean, comfortable indoor environments. So that is the criticality of conditioning the inside. Hence, providing a healthy, comfortable indoor environment is crucial in our economy all over, globally. It shouldn't happen that only the developed countries get the opportunity. It is a prerogative right of every person. But adopting energy efficient methods should be the aim and objective. Now, who is anybody can guess on this, please? Inventor of world's first modern air conditioning system. Some of you might know. It's a very popular figure, and there is a company already in his name. Who is the father of modern day air conditioning? Very right. It's this gentleman called Willis Haviland Currier. He is the father of modern AC. And he invented the modern day AC unit in Buffalo, US, closer to, a little closer to the above North New York. A very cold region, a state which has the Niagara Falls, which even froze once in the last century. So that is the extreme temperature drop that happens in the area. So very likely that it was invented in a very required state. So July 1902, the credit goes to Mr. Haviland Currier for the invention of a modern AC system. And then he has the company, which is against his name, which he founded, and one of the leading companies in US and other countries as well. So he proudly stands with the machine, with the equipment that he invented. And the main intent to invent AC, the objective, was to meet the demand of better productivity in the workplaces. So there was a time, last century, the Industrial Revolution, the rise of various kinds of newer jobs, right? New offices, new scope of work coming in, a lot of industrial production. So the AC intended to meet the demand of better working condition so that there is a better productivity or output at the workplace. And today, Currier Corporation is the biggest AC manufacturer and marketing corporation in the world, leading in central air conditioning. So there are two types, unitary and central. Central is for the large scale, bigger buildings, and we have a forerunner here. That's another of the reproductions of central AC, which was bulky then. Now probably the sizes have reduced. Then post the invention, 1902, there was 1914. The next, I will be discussing only the main points in history chronologically. Every stage there has been some improvement, but let us look at the prominent ones. So 1914, air conditioning comes home to the city of Minneapolis in the state of Minnesota, USA. It is also another regional aspect which faces extreme winters and summers, but winters go much below the zero mark, and there is snow for nearly 3 to 4 months. So 1914, we see the AC entering the thresholds of a home. 1930, the president gets the AC. The White House in Washington DC also provided with air conditioning system. Further, 1931, the unitary system, the small one, window AC was invented. Window AC, which we frequently see in most of our buildings. 1939, Packard invents the first air conditioned car. So the entry of air conditioning into transportation, much essential. It led to a lot of progressive processes ahead. 1942, US builds its first summer peaking power plant made to handle the growing electrical load of air conditioning. So you see how inventions happen and how progresses move. So there is that always constant lookout for better solutions. Sometimes we topple, but again we have to pick up and move ahead. 1970s was, I think, one of the major breakthroughs as central air conditioning enters the scene. Central air conditioning led to a lot of architectural new innovative designs and exploring the quantity and floor plates and going much beyond than what was happening. So central AC enters the realm. So this is the home where the AC enters the residential thresholds in Minneapolis, state of Minnesota. all right? So you see this kind of slow roofs because it's a city of heavy smog. So wherever we encounter such a climate, we know that we have to clear the snow load from the building top, so we end up with slope roofs. Alright, shall I move ahead? Okay, so this was the publication to the right side, Rational Psychrometric Formulae by Willis. One of the known first known publications in the field. So it talks about the refrigeration, the psychrometric science behind refrigeration and AC. We have done a chapter in detail on this in the module 1. Then this is the drawing of the first central AC system. What a novelty to look at it, isn't it? You have the AC plant to the right side, the single story building, and then you have the built spaces where the AC is entering the space, elevation, sectional elevation. So this was the Buffalo fan system, humidifying, heating and ventilating the cotton mills. So Buffalo, because it had a lot of power generation with itself owing to the Niagara power plant is there. So a lot of factories and industries were seeing formulated there. Then in 1994, coming to our recent times, Freon is linked to the gas used in the refrigeration or air conditioning is linked to ozone depletion. So slowly man started to realize that it is leading to the disastrous ozone depletion and banned in several countries ahead of that. The auto manufacturers were required to switch to the less harmful refrigerants R134A by 1996. So this was a major awakening call to something that happened maybe in 1960s. The impact started to be seen 20 to 30 years later. So this has been one of the most drastic impacts of refrigeration industry. So brands like Honeywell and Carrier develop coolants that are more environmentally friendly than all. So there is a solution. So there was a lot of R&D that happened, and the dangerous refrigerants started to be replaced by better alternatives. 2009, 87% of US households were noted or surveyed to have air conditioning. So 87%, quite a substantial figure in 2009. I think now it is almost 98, probably. We have to check that. So most of the houses and offices are related with that. Now, emissions from modern AC is a great threat to an increasingly warming climate. The global warming has been witnessed owing to the emissions from the air conditioning and refrigeration. That equates to about 100 million tons of carbon dioxide being released into the atmosphere annually. So 2020, last year, there were 16 of the United States state components, including states like New York, Maryland, Connecticut, who have banned or are working to eliminate the use of hydrofluorocarbons. So that has been an encouraging move from a developed nation as US, which can be taken ahead eventually. Now coming to our own nation, India, and what was the evolution of AC here? Voltas launched the India's first air conditioner in 1954. We got independence. So probably that was a striking note to begin the progress. Then first split air conditioner was introduced in 1984. So most of you would not be bought even by then. But for knowledge, first AC, split AC. Split AC is what you see normally in most of the spaces. You have an indoor unit and the outdoor unit, two units. So splitting one component into two. First floor standing AC was introduced in 1993. It's called as the console model, which stands on the floor, portable, sleek, and helpful because it is in the occupied zone of the room. Then sub 110 AC, because Indian conditions also might require not too heavy capacity of AC for the smaller rooms. So smaller tonnages also introduced in 2000. Then 2002, another milestone in the AC arena. Government of India set up BEE, the Bureau of Energy Efficiency, on 1st March 2002 under Energy Conservation Act of 2001. So as we know, there was the Montreal Protocol that happened somewhere in 1987. So all the nations met there to discuss the negative impacts of these kind of harmful gases, fluids used in various industries like air conditioning, refrigeration, automobiles. So the Montreal Protocol was an important milestone, and there were decisions taken that the countries have to phase out the use of these harmful refrigerants and adapt to environmental friendly ones. Now the mission of the BEE is to assist in developing policies and strategies with a thrust on self-regulation and market principles. So with that aim, the primary objective was reducing energy intensity of the Indian economy. Indian economy just picking up 50 years of independence probably then. And then we realized we have this, but this is a negative impact. So we have the obligation towards the environment, and the government of India is taking various measures in this front. So that was a brief look at the major happenings in the air conditioning. It is essential to know how something evolves. So that gives us an idea of what happened, what were the hardships, what were the advantages, and what is the scope for further evolutions, we ourselves being professionally liable to these as architects. Scope of air conditioning. So we will understand the importance and relevance of air conditioning in our buildings. So air conditioning is a process of treating air, indoor airs, in an internal environment to establish and maintain required standards of temperature, humidity, cleanliness, and motion. So beautifully put, the intent is to create an indoor environment in our homes, offices, schools, colleges, gathering spaces, public spaces, in order to establish and maintain the required or expected standards of comfort in terms of four main items: temperature, humidity, cleanliness, and motion of air. We will see the conditions ahead. Point one, temperature. So temperature refers to how hot or how cold a substance or air is. So in summers, the temperature goes up to 36 degrees Celsius, 40 degrees in hot areas. Plus the added humidity in the coastal cities, right? So our ambient temperature that a person or human is comfortable is around 23 to 24 degrees Celsius. And when we encounter 38, 40 degree, it is not a comfortable situation to work, to live, to give better output when we are performing a task. So the scope of AC with respect to temperature is cooling the air during harsh summers or heating during winters. There are cities, Delhi itself goes below 10 degree. Then the northern states below 5, up to even sometimes below 0. So that is the intent, heating or cooling the air. Humidity, adding or removing water vapor from air. Humidity is also a very crucial factor of the air. So we have to resort to either remove excessive water vapor or add when the air is too dry. Both are not good. So somewhere we say optimum humidity between, how much is it? What do you think is a comfortable humidity range? Very right. Somewhere between 35, 45 up to 50, 60. It is subjective to the place, but then something in that range is comfortable. Something below 20, 30, a lot of dryness, it leads to other issues like people encounter that dryness of the skin, dryness of the nose, sometimes the nose bleeds. So these are the things. If it is excessive humidity, like in the coastal regions, people who dwell in Kerala or Chennai might be aware. The humidity and the heat sometimes leads to less work output. So we have to remove humidity in such instances. Then cleanliness, keeping the air that we breathe clean, prerogative. Now with the, it refers to the quality of the air and adopting filtration in the air conditioning to remove the undesirable contaminants such as dust, dirt, organic volatile compounds, viruses, bacteria, these kind of things. So you have to remove that from the air that we breathe. Secondly, you create a proper ventilation by influx of fresh clean air to dilute the contaminants. So with respect to cleanliness, that is the objective or scope of our air conditioning system. Finally, motion of the air, the movement of the air velocity, the velocity with which air is supplied into the room, and its wonderfully well-composed distribution. And appropriate equipment and calibration is required. If this is not adopted, what happens? There is stagnation of the air, which is bad again. And there are pockets in the room where stagnation happens and air is not ventilating it properly owing to the velocity. So these four are the primary scope of air conditioning. I hope it's clear. Now, we will look at those were the four primary conditions. Now, what are the other important aspects that AC will take care of? Sound control, noise control. It is an auxiliary function of AC. You are in a building, you need to have a quiet environment, but the land uses outside or the road outside is adding to the noise. AC gives wonderful respite from the noise. But there is sometimes what happens, AC itself, the AC equipment itself becomes a noise generator. So now that time whose fault is it? It is the product that we have chosen or the man the technical installation that has gone wrong or the design, spatial design by the architect. Calibration by the engineer might have faltered. So all air conditioning need not regulate all the above mentioned parameters. So it is not essential that each and every unit will take care of all the above parameters of temperature, humidity, or velocity. They might be having even scope under one or two aspects also, only temperature, humidity, only temperature and velocity of the air, humidification factor might not be there. So that we have to know. For example, hot water or steam heating system controls air temperature only during the hot seasons, only during the heating season, sorry, when you want the space to be heated during cold seasons, is correct. So that is how scope of air conditioning is listed. Now, applications of air conditioning. Largely speaking, two intentions of AC, one is human comfort, another is process control. So human comfort is what we saw in the previous slides, creating comfort conditions for people per se. They have to be happy, safe, and comfortable. Process control is when there are instances like manufacturing, or there are instances in hospitals where the intent is creating safety to the equipments, computers, bio labs, where production or inventions of medicine is happening, vaccinations happening. So that is meant for process control. So these two become the main platforms under which air conditioning can be used. So I think the next session we will continue on the importance of AC with respect to being unitary or central AC. So we will conclude this session until this stage, and the second session we will continue with the remaining aspects under the section. All right. Thank you for being here, and hope you have taken down notes, and any clarifications, please write to me.